This is episode 45 of the Reading Cove podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining our online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com. For August 2014, we're discussing The Weight of Silence by Heather Gudenkauf. So hi, I am Millenia in Florida.
I'm Roberta in Georgia.
And we are two members of the Reading Cove who are here to share our thoughts on the August Cove pick, which is The Weight of Silence by Heather Gudenkauf, and it's our 165th pick, and it was chosen by me, yours truly. So what did we think about it? There's some mixed reviews from the group. I personally wasn't a huge fan of the writing style.
Well, I think that some people felt like you did. As usual, I probably liked it a little bit more than you did.
Right.
It's your pick. But we know from the past that sometimes our picks don't turn out quite the way we thought they would.
Exactly.
They look good on the synopsis, but then you get into it. But overall, I liked it, but it was kind of tricky staying with the storyline because there were like so many different points of view, all these different characters with their points of view. And so you really had to pay close attention. I mean, I think the premise, the storyline itself was good, but it probably would be a lot less confusing if they had had less points of view, in my humble opinion.
I usually like multiple points of view in a story because you get more insight and it tends to make things more well-rounded, but that was not the case with this story. I mean, it really just turned into backstory dump, and that weighed down the narrative so much of something that really should have been edge of your seat.
Right.
And I realized that, you know, it starts off in my opinion, in a way that just killed any chance that this book could have had any suspense. And to pull the reader through by the prologue telling you that Callie comes back safely.
Right.
I mean, I just feel like from there, you know that everything's going to be fine. She comes back and she talks for the first time. It's like, So there was like no suspense. I think that was a huge mistake. We should have been wondering.
Right.
If she's going to come back okay, if or are they harmed or, you know what I mean? Instead, you know.
You know, except you don't know about Petra, but still, I agree that was probably why I gave it a B as opposed to a B+. You know, or higher for the book, because stuff like that, it needs to have more suspense.
Yes. The mystery was not there.
The mystery was not there. I mean, you do get to know a fair amount, like you said, about each character because they do, you know, tell about their backstory and what's happened to them and how they came to be at this place and time.
Right.
So I thought, you know, that it was good. But like I said, sometimes, and I do like multiple points of view because if you just have it all from first person or if you just have it all from, you know, one third person, then it's just not quite as, like I said, as full and rich. It needs, most stories, unless they're just really different, need more than one point of view to get an overall picture about what's going on with all these different characters.
Yeah, and these characters just, I didn't find any of them to be sympathetic. And I had posted to the group that Tony's the mom whose child is missing. And she seemed to be the focal. I mean, you have Petra and Martin and her parents, but it seemed like Callie was really the focal character. And her mom, to me.
Yes.
And Tony, I was not sympathizing with her because it's like, I understand the author needed to give this backstory for them, you know, starting it where she did and everything. But it just seemed odd that your 7-year-old daughter's missing and you have all this time to be sitting around remembering, you know, your romance with Lewis.
Right.
You know, I mean, thinking, still consumed so much with that because we're getting that from her point of view and Lewis's.
Right.
And it seems to me that in this type of crisis, that's the last thing they would be thinking about.
No, I mean, you could tell their backstory some other way, but not.
Right, exactly.
Not in the midst of, you know, what happened to a child, because you see stuff on the news all the time and people are just hysterical, just literally hysterical if anything's, you know, happened to their child.
Exactly. You're consumed. Your daughter has disappeared.
Right.
It's the woods. She could be anywhere. There was another kid in the neighborhood or something that had been killed, had been found killed, right? The other woman's daughter or something.
Yeah.
And I would be freaking out. The last thing I could do is tell somebody about my history with the sheriff.
Right. You know?
I mean, really?
Yeah, I mean, that's another reason why it didn't get, you know, even higher grade. Like I said, the story idea was really good, but some of the way that she developed it, I would have done differently. Granted, this is her debut novel, so right. You figure sometimes people have to grow from the first. You know, some people have the first one as their masterpiece, but a lot of people, they need to kind of polish their craft and go forward. But like I said, yeah, that you needed to know why these characters were acting the way they did, but I agree with you, it could have been shown in a slightly different manner that would have made it a little bit more suspenseful and what you would expect from people's behavior.
And that would have raised the tension too. It would have been more believable.
Right.
Speaking about their backstory, the reason that she left Lewis and married Griff, and by the way, Griff, I couldn't help but thinking of Back to the Future every time. Griff Tannen.
Yeah, I had thought about that, but you're right. Yeah, I mean, because that guy was, Back to the Future was a definite also.
Yeah, and I've never heard of anybody else with that name. So every time I read the name, I just pictured Griff from Back to the Future.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
This Griff was even meaner.
Worse. Oh, yeah, yeah. But the reason that she left Lewis, because Lewis was going away for college, right?
Right.
And she felt like, oh, everybody leaves me and, you know, I'm breaking up with you. And then she marries him and he works out of state half the time.
Yeah.
It didn't make any sense to me.
Well, I mean, I guess, you know, she figured, but basically their home, she could stay there in the same hometown and not have to move away. Cause I think at one time she probably figured that, Lewis would not only go off to college, but that he might go someplace else bigger to have a better career path, but he didn't after all. So
yeah, I don't know. Cause he kept telling her, you know, I'll be back. I'm just going away, you know, for school or I'll visit or whatever.
Right.
It just didn't seem like a good enough reason for her to, give up on him and then marry this guy.
Yeah, well, I mean, Griff was definitely the temptation of the bad boy because even when, before they got married, he wasn't a really shining star.
He already had
certain issues. But sometimes, unfortunately, girls and young women do stupid things. They get attracted to the bad boys as opposed to someone that would actually be better for them.
Yeah, but she didn't really love Griff. She really loved Lewis.
Well, yeah. So, I mean, with Griff, it was just, he was there, and I guess even after he started really showing his true colors, and she and the children were happy when he was off in Alaska. That was the best time for them.
Yeah.
But they keep saying they're sorry, but it happened just like with Griff, it keeps happening over and over again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess that's why she wasn't very sympathetic, and I couldn't find much sympathy for her. And I don't think the narrative helped to make her a sympathetic character at all.
Yeah, well, she loved her children, but at the same time, especially after she fell down the stairs and lost the baby,
mm-hmm.
that would have been it. You know, I probably would have left a long time before that, because early on in my marriage, I told my husband, I said, you know, the first time you hit me, I'm gone. I don't that kind of stuff.
Exactly.
You
know,
I had never experienced myself before, but you, even growing up, you eventually see stuff, what happens with neighbors or other stuff. People try to hide it, but it'll show up, unfortunately.
Oh, absolutely. It was so obvious with this guy. And then you had Martin and his wife, who he says, oh, you know what, maybe we don't have to have children. And then she goes off and tries to kill herself.
I know.
I was like, what the... they really just read like a bunch of very uneducated, you know, bumpkins. I don't know. They didn't, he was a college professor.
Right.
But they just, I don't know, they didn't read like very, like people that are interesting.
Right.
I don't know, to me.
Yeah, you know, then with Martin, that he had overcome his background. He had, sort of reinvented himself. But at the same time, I think he went back to his roots of being not quite the professor type at all, because he wanted to become a vigilante and take matters into his own hands. Mm-hmm. After he had decided that it was Griff's fault that his daughter was missing and hurt. Right. So because and you can't blame him, most daddies, if anything happens to their child, woe be to the person who's responsible if they can find them, that's for sure.
That's true.
But yeah, I with Filda, you think she's kind of troubled in a certain way and
very
emotional. So she probably could use some help. Of course, probably after they finally got Petra back and things were changed a lot, they moved away to get away from all this other reminders. Mm-hmm. But you think after that, they probably, all of them have to have some serious therapy after going through that horrible experience.
Absolutely. Because, you're right. Petra's fate, we didn't know. And even though she was one of the narrators, we did get, her perspective up to a certain point.
Right.
Not, it curiously stopped when that attack happened.
Well, yeah. Well, from that day forward, she really wasn't her old self anymore.
No.
Think she was probably never going to have a truly normal life after, something so traumatic like that. And plus, from what it sounded, they didn't go into a lot of detail, but it just sounded like from her injury, she was going to be handicapped in certain ways for the rest of her day. She wasn't going to ever be able to fulfill her full potential.
Yeah.
That she had at 7 years old.
Yeah. And what did you think of Callie being the one who finds her?
Well, it's possible, as they said, that they were kindred spirits and they knew what the other person was thinking or what was going on, even without talking. So I found that to be more believable than certain other things.
Right. Like what?
Well, I mean, like you said, like some of these other backstories about people worrying about things from the past when they needed to worry about the present only.
Exactly. And I don't know. I think if my child went missing, I don't think anybody could keep me from tearing out into those woods to go look for her.
Oh, I know.
I couldn't just sit home.
Know what these other people told you, I'd think, well, to heck with them.
Yeah.
I mean,
somebody else can sit at home and wait to hear something, but if in case someone calls or something, but I'm getting out of here. I'm going to look for my child or something.
Yeah, I mean, I could see if you knew they had been kidnapped and you had to be there to answer the phone calls for the people
right.
that had kidnapped them, but when you know they're probably in the nearby woods, then yeah, I'd be out there at the front of the pack.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine not doing something like that.
Right. Yeah, I did think it was nice that Mrs. McIntyre, that she was, since she'd been through so much, she was really sweet to help the others as much as she could, because every day of her life that she would be grieving over her daughter.
Yeah, and I thought, was it Lewis or someone else who was hesitant to let her get involved because they thought her presence might scare Tony too much and Martin, and I was like, what? Because her child had been killed, it's like, oh,
right.
Maybe we don't really want her around.
It's still going to be with her forever, but at the same time, she could truly sympathize with them since she had been through such a horrible time.
Exactly. We've just started our discussion in the group, and there are a few people who said, they've enjoyed it, and others not so much for all the reasons that we're talking about. It wasn't the best debut. It wasn't the best. I think, to me, if I had to put my finger on one problem with it, it's the plotting. I don't think it was very well plotted. The backstory dumps, I renamed it the weight of backstory dumps. Because that bogged down this train, something that really should be gripping, very
right.
boring to me. And snail's pace when you've got all these different points of view coming at you. It should be, much better. And so, yeah, I think it is her first book and she's written others. So I hope that, the others are better. I'm not sure if I'd, be quick to try one, but.
Well, probably not me either at this point. But I said I just can't afford to add too much more into my tower of books.
Me too. Because I gave this one a C-.
Well, and that's not horrible, but it wasn't the
Yeah, I was disappointed because I've had this in my pile a few years, and it just looked really interesting. I think it had gotten, a lot of buzz, and that's how it caught my eye. I got it, and I thought, this should be good. So it was a big disappointment for me.
Well, and that can happen, and different people are going to have different ways of looking at things, as we well know.
Yeah, and what they find interesting. Because I think that's what it comes down to with us reading books. It's just what interests you, what holds your attention.
Right.
Yeah, so would you, if she wrote a sequel to this, would you read it?
Maybe. Maybe.
All right, so any final thoughts?
Enjoyed it overall, but it probably wasn't my favorite book of the month for sure. I'm glad that other people liked it and that hopefully we'll have a good discussion. People can express more at the discussion.
Yeah, I think we'll have a really good discussion.
Sometimes there's more things to bounce back and forth.
Yeah, and the issues that it raises, like right. What is a mother like when her 7-year-old is taken from her house in the middle of the night?
Right.
And at first, she was like, oh, she's fine, she's fine. That was the other thing I was rolling my eyes about. Oh, she goes out into the woods all the time. I'm like, what?
Without her shoes?
I know. And not only that, but in the middle of the night?
Yeah, the middle of the night and then without your shoes. That would be my first clue that it was it could be foul play.
Yeah, I was like looking at her like, are you on something? Like she was talking like somebody who's like high on marijuana or something. Just not normal.
I think she had been abused for so long and so badly that your mindset must change after that.
I don't know. I think you're right on that, but I don't know, in this book.
I've had a good husband, but you just see so many things about these people, even people that are professionals, even more educated than she was, that you think, well, how did you get yourself in this horrible situation?
Yeah.
And why didn't you try to get yourself and your children away from it?
Exactly.
But it's almost like these people become like prisoners where they lost their will. And then there are cases where people try to get away and the abuser goes after them with disastrous results. So
yeah. You
can see both sides of it.
Yeah, you're right. There are plenty of Tonys out there.
Right.
And people want to shake them. Like, are you crazy? Wake up.
He's going to kill you.
Exactly. Or your kids. Look what he did. The little girl won't talk. Oh, yeah, we didn't talk about that. That Callie's, you know, she wasn't speaking for, what was it, 4 years?
Well, three. Well,
3 years?
3 years, yeah.
And it was because he, you know, he told her, oh, if you don't shut up, I forget what he said, but something horrible.
Something horrible, yeah.
And that, you know, shocked her into silence of fear. Like, you know, so she never spoke again.
Yeah, well, she's afraid to say anything, you know.
Exactly.
For fear that something else would happen to her after she saw how badly her mother was hurt. And then at the same time, later on, he's blaming her for not talking. Of course, like I said, he wasn't the sharpest tool in the shed, so he couldn't probably connect the fact that he'd threatened her, and that was what was causing the problem.
Yeah.
And then people outside the home, they didn't know the story. They wouldn't know what the link to it either, because I think that Mr. Wilson probably could have figured it out if he'd known more about Callie's backstory, but he didn't.
Yeah.
Because she couldn't tell him, and then even the mom's going to hide it, even after these horrible things happen.
Yeah, and then at the end, it jumps ahead 6 years, which I thought was a little bit odd. Maybe, you know, if it jumped ahead to where Callie was, because she's 13
right.
in the epilogue.
Right.
So I'm like, why did she pick that age? You know, why didn't she jump ahead a little further?
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know if she just wanted to show her as a teenager. Maybe that's what I'm thinking, maybe.
All right, so that is our discussion of The Weight of Silence by Heather Gudenkauf. Thanks to our listeners for tuning in, and continue to leave us your comments. Let us know if you read The Weight of Silence and what you thought, and if you've read any of her other books. And stay tuned for next episode. We'll be discussing The Abbey by Chris Culver. See you next time. Bye.
Bye.